Helena, my name is Eliana Anderson.
My name is Alicia Anderson.
Once upon a time, there was...
a bunny?
No. One day, Jesus went to Jerusalem on his donkey. They all gathered twigs and they waved them in the air.
They threw their coats on the ground.
Hosanna, Hosanna.
It's the Son of God.
Then on the last night with his friends, he had a meal with them. They ate the Last Supper. He said that to remember him every time they had that supper. He went to the garden to pray
Gethsemane.
Gethsemane. But the disciples fell asleep with the donkey. After Jesus prayed, mingers took them away.
So drugs were bad.
Jesus said that he was God's son. They didn't like it at all. The people got so mad that they put Jesus on a cross. His mom and his friends were very sad because they loved him. He died because he wanted to forgive our sins. They brought him off the cross to a cave that had a stone so he couldn't get out. Saturday, they were all sad and they were all scared. On a Sunday, they went to look and they saw he was not in there anymore. The tomb was empty. An angel told them that Jesus had risen from the dead. The women came running to the disciples to tell them, but they would not believe them. Jesus came in the room. They were all surprised and they were all happy. Since they were so happy, they had a month together. After they had so much fun, Jesus went onto a top of a hill and he waved goodbye all to his friends. He said, "I will come back someday. While I'm gone, tell everybody about me." And he went up to heaven. The disciples, they told everybody that Jesus would always forgive them. Now I know that he loves me and my little sister Alicia and my mom and my dad, and he loves everybody. That's why me and my sister love to dress up and go to church and be pretty as we celebrate Easter. By celebrating, we say to Jesus, "Thank you and we love you."
Well, good morning. It's Easter Sunday. Happy Easter to you. He is risen. Amen. I'm reminded of the time when I got to go to Israel, and there's a place called the Garden Tomb. And on the door of that tomb, they have a plaque that reads, "He is not here. He is risen." And I was able to step into that door and see that the tomb is in fact empty. And so today we worship a risen Savior. Amen. Let's worship him together.
You said in 3 days you would rise. In the waiting, my Sometimes people ask why. Why do we do this?
When we came up here, I didn't feel capable. Because I was scared.
Why do we take our families away from places that are familiar and move to places that are far off?
My wife was 9 months pregnant, and we did not know one person who lived in the city.
Why do we come to where there's nothing so we can try and start something?
The Lord really just, He broke my heart for this city before I stepped off the plane.
Why do we stress and strain and struggle and sweat just to make life better for someone else?
There's so many people that are broken, that are lost, and it's heartbreaking.
Yes, sometimes people ask why, and when they do, we tell them. There's places where the truth hasn't yet reached.
We need to share the gospel and reach out our community.
We tell them there's a God who loves them so much, He sent us.
God spoke to us, broke our hearts for the city, and God's call trumps all.
And we tell them there are people who love them so much, they give so that we can go.
When people give to missions, things happen. New believers are getting baptized. New churches are started.
So, when people ask why, that's what we tell them. We tell them it's the gospel. It's all about the gospel.
Hey, let me share some announcements with you. As you're giving, through whatever methods you're giving to the church, be sure to do that for your Annie Armstrong offering as well. That money will go to supporting the North American Mission Board. And so we hope that you'll continue to be faithful in giving to that. It's a really important offering that we wanted to make you aware of, remind you of. Also, a few things are coming up this week. At 6:30 on Tuesday, 6:30 p.m., we'll be having our prayer time for Ignite Randolph, and that will be on Zoom. Again, and then also Wednesday at 3 p.m., Pastor Mitch is continuing a Bible study, and that will be on Facebook Live, so we don't want you to miss that. Jeff Joyce is here from the Randolph Baptist Association. He's bringing the word to us, and so we're excited to have him. We really appreciate his willingness to preach this morning. And also, before Jeff comes and preaches during our offertory time, we're going to have a special presentation from the Knight family, and they're going to do a special performance for us, and you are going to really enjoy that. And let's pray together. Father, we love you. We thank you for the opportunity that we have to give back to you. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity we have to remember your blessings upon us. And Lord, I pray that you might just continue to bless us as we worship together. Lord, I pray that you would speak through your servant Jeff as he brings the message. And Lord, I thank you for the Knight family and the gifts that you've given them to share with us this morning. We praise you. We praise you especially today as we remember that you are a living Savior. We worship you today in Jesus' name. Amen.
that his father had forsaken him, turned his back on his son, despising our sin. All hell seemed to whisper, just forget it, he's dead. Then the father looked down to his son and said, arise, my love, arise, my love. The grave no longer has a hold on you. No more death stain, no more suffering. Arise, arise, my love. The earth trembled and the tomb began to shake, and like lightning from heaven, the stone was rolled away. And this dead man, the guards, they all stood there in fright as the power of love displayed its might.
Then suddenly a melody was everywhere.
The words of creation had been longing to hear.
A sweet sound of victory, so loud and clear. Arise, my love. Arise.
Crossroad Baptist Church this morning. We're together celebrating Easter Sunday morning, Resurrection Sunday, just a little different, isn't it? 52 years old, and I've never experienced anything like this, but I'm glad to be able to be with you guys today, and I hope that as we spend some time together in God's Word, you can be encouraged and inspired as we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So let's begin by going to the Lord in prayer. Father, we are so grateful for what your Son did for us on the cross of Calvary, for your willingness to accept his payment of his shed blood for our salvation, for the forgiveness of our sins. And Father, we pray that as we celebrate as Christians across the world today, the resurrection of Jesus Christ, Lord, that we would be able to not only know this truth, but live this truth as we go forward. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, we are here today and we are celebrating the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And I'm grateful to be able to take God's word and to share a little bit with you from the scripture. I want to ask you a question this morning as we get started. Are you living the resurrection life? Are you living the resurrection life? I had to ask myself that question. Am I living the resurrection life? And you'll say, well, what do you mean, preacher? And we're going to get into that in just a moment. But before we do, I had an opportunity just a few weeks ago to be in Israel. And we were wandering around Jerusalem the last few days that we were there, taking in the sights. And as many of you know, there's a couple of different places that they think Jesus may have been crucified and buried. And we were taking in those sights and had a third suggestion offered us. And I looked at one of the pastors that was traveling with me and I said, you know what the wonderful thing is? There's one thing I've not seen in Jerusalem while we've been here. He looked at me and he said, what's that? I said, I hadn't seen a body. There is no body of Jesus Christ, no matter where you go in Jerusalem, no matter where they tell you the crucifixion took place or where the tomb they think the tomb is, there's no body. And you know why? Because he is risen. I love Matthew's account of the resurrection. I go back to it on a regular basis and hear the ladies come to the tomb and the angel makes the statement, I know you're looking for Jesus, but he's not here. He's risen just as he said. Isn't that a wonderful truth this morning? And guys, you know, there's Christians all around the world today that know that is truth. But the question is, are we living like that is truth? So that's what I want us to talk about today. Are we living like the resurrection is real? So I want to take you to another resurrection in Scripture. I want you to go with me back to John chapter 11. And I want to look at a couple of verses that are surrounding the resurrection of Lazarus. You say, well, preacher, why are we going there this morning? I hope you'll bear with me and we'll see that in John chapter 11, beginning in verse number 19, I want to read a few passages of scripture to you. If you have your Bibles, you can read along with me. It says, and many of the Jews came to Martha and Mary to comfort them concerning their brother, which we know is Lazarus. Then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him, but Mary sat still in the house. Then said Martha unto Jesus, Lord, if thou hast been here, my brother would not have died. But I know, underline that word, I know that even now whatsoever thou wilt ask of God, God will give it to thee. Jesus said unto her, thy brother shall rise again. Martha saith unto him, I know that he shall rise again. See that word? No. In the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. And he looked at Martha and he said, believest thou this? You see, in this passage of scripture, we see the sisters and they're struggling with the death of their brother Lazarus, Martha in particular in the passage we read. And a couple of different occasions, she makes the statement about what she knows about Jesus. You know, I know that God will listen to you. I know that one day my brother will be resurrected. There's a knowledge that she has, but yet she's not living in a belief of the resurrection. She's not living in a belief of what Christ is capable of doing. It's almost like she's questioning Jesus' ability and his love and loyalty towards Lazarus. Why didn't you come? Why weren't you here? If you had been here, you could have done something about it. And truth is, he could have. But in his wisdom and in God's plan, he didn't come. And Martha was struggling with the plan that God had. If you look down a little further in verse 32, Mary came to Jesus. It says, then when Mary was come where Jesus was, she saw him and she fell down at his feet, saying unto him, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. Same thing. Mary was in that same place. She was hurting. Her heart was heavy. She had lost someone that she cared about dearly. And she looked at Jesus and she said, Jesus, if you were the friend that we thought you were, you could have come and Jesus, and Lazarus never would have had to die. See, they knew all about what Jesus was capable of doing. But yet, they hadn't grasped the truth that Jesus said in verse 25. Notice the statement that Jesus said in verse 25. He said, when he was speaking to Martha, he said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth on me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Jesus said, I am the resurrection. Resurrection hadn't taken place yet, guys, remember? But here's Jesus speaking in the present tense, saying, I am the resurrection. It is about me. Here we are on Resurrection Sunday, and we're celebrating that Jesus Christ came forth out of the grave. The reality is, he is that resurrection. That same person that we place our belief in is the person who changes and makes the resurrection something worthwhile, something that can be a reality to us. When we look at these ladies and the place that they found themselves in their life, we realize that, hey, they were going through a difficult time, but they were struggling with the resurrection being a reality for them. If you go a little further, we see how the people responded. Jesus went to the tomb, and as he made his way to the tomb, you see the moving statement that Jesus wept. And the following verses following that, verse 37 says, and some of them, the mourners, said, could not this man which opened the eyes of the blind have caused that even this man, Lazarus, should have not died? So here's the people that were surrounding the death of Lazarus, the people that had come to comfort Mary and Martha. They were looking at Jesus and they were saying, hey, this man Jesus, he does some miraculous things. He's got the capability to give sight to the blind. He's got the capability to cause the sick to be healed. Couldn't he have given Lazarus life? Why didn't he come earlier? So here are these people that had been followers of Jesus, that knew who he was, that knew his capabilities, and yet they're questioning him. They're questioning his love for Lazarus. They're questioning his loyalty to Mary and Martha. And you know, I think sometimes in our walk with the Lord as Christians, we find ourselves in that place as well. We wonder, it's not that we don't know who Jesus is and we don't know what Jesus is capable of doing, but we look at circumstances in our life and we wonder, why hadn't God done this for us? Why hadn't Jesus moved in our life to help us this way? Why have we lost our job in this pandemic? Why are our friends struggling? Why are we locked down? And we wonder, where is God in all of this? Where is Jesus in all of this? And as Christians, it's not that we don't have the knowledge, but do we believe that God's got a plan for our life? You see, I think Jesus struggled with this as he listened to the people. There's a couple of passages I want you to look at, a couple of verses in this passage. Look with me, if you would, in verse number 33. Mary had just asked Jesus in 32, if you'd have been here, my brother could have not died. And it says, and when Jesus therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews also weeping, which came with her, he groaned in his spirit and was troubled. That word groaned, it really has a context of being angry. And some people say, well, he was angry because of the grief that took place. And that would be true because he loved Lazarus. But I also think that it caused Jesus grief to hear people that had followed him, that had trusted him, that had believed in him, doubt his loyalty, doubt his love. Martha and Mary were struggling. Jesus, why didn't you come? And it was heavy on his heart that they wouldn't trust him, that they wouldn't think that he had the best in mind for them. On over in verse number 38, when the people had made that same assumption, made that same statement that Jesus could have kept Lazarus from dying, Jesus says in verse 38, Jesus therefore again, groaning in himself, cometh to the grave. Jesus was upset that the people that had followed him, that had saw him do all these miracles, were struggling that maybe he didn't care enough for Lazarus. Maybe he didn't love Mary and Martha enough. I think that weighed on the heart of Jesus, and it bothered Jesus, and I think it bothers Jesus today when we choose not, as believers, as Christians, to want to follow him and be committed to him and trust his plan that he has for our lives. Again, I'm not saying that we don't have the knowledge of who Christ is and that God has a plan for us, but are we living in that knowledge? Are we letting that knowledge be what drives us? I want you to notice something that takes place. As Martha and some of these people move from just having knowledge to believing, we read in verse 24 that Martha said, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection. She had knowledge, but then Jesus spoke to her and he said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, notice that word, he that believeth in me, not he that know about me, but he that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And at the end of that verse 26, he says, and whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. And he looked at Martha and he said, Martha, do you believe this? In verse 27, she said, yea, Lord, I believe that thou art the Christ, the Son of God, which should come into the world. You notice Martha had transitioned from just a knowledge of what Jesus was capable of doing as he stood there and said to her, Martha, I'm the resurrection. I am what you're looking for. I am the hope that you need. She'd moved from just knowledge about Jesus and the past events that Jesus had done in her life to saying, I believe who you are and who you are and in who you are right now. How did it make a difference in her life? Look at verse 28. And when she had said, she went her way and called Mary, her sister, secretly, saying, the master has come and calleth for thee. That word master there, that name, means the teacher. See, Jesus had just taught Martha something. And she wanted her sister not only to know about who Jesus was, but to have the hope of living in the resurrection. So she sent her sister, Mary, go see the Savior. I know you're hurting. You need to go see the Savior. Mary came to Jesus with the very same question that Martha had had. The people that were following had the very same question. But I want you to notice something. As you read through the events, Jesus went to the tomb there and he spoke the words. He made this wonderful prayer to the Father. And then he spoke the words, Lazarus, come forth. And Lazarus came out of the grave. Notice what happens. Verse 45. Then many of the Jews which came to Mary had seen the things which Jesus did. These people who had been talking before about, you know, couldn't Jesus have done something to help Lazarus? You know, given the insinuation that he wasn't as really loyal and loving to Mary and Martha and Lazarus as he could have been. Listen to what happens. And when these had seen the things which Jesus did, believed on him. Now it wasn't just about knowing the things he'd done in the past and what he was capable of doing. Now it was believing in him. He had just resurrected Lazarus from the dead. He had just expressed his love for this family. He had shown them how much he cared for them. He had taken the loneliness and the hurt they were feeling, and he'd done away with it. You see, you remember when he talked to his disciples before he left, they're like, why are we going there? Surely he's already dead. No, this is part of God's plan. I'm going to show you guys something. You see, guys, we've got to move past the point of just knowing who Jesus is to believing what he's capable of doing. Many Christians have a knowledge of Christ, but are we living the resurrection life, moving from knowledge to belief? You see, spending time with Jesus, communicating with Jesus, listening to Jesus, had moved Martha to the place where she was living in the resurrection life. And now, many of those people that saw what Jesus was capable of doing were not questioning him anymore, but they were living in the reality that he was the resurrection and the life. Verse 48 says this: they went and told some of the Pharisees, and listen to what the Pharisees said. If we let him thus alone, all men will believe on him. Can you imagine that? If we, as the church, as the body of Christ, started living the resurrection life, not just having knowledge of who Jesus is, but living like we believe it, can you imagine how it would affect our communities? Can you imagine how it would affect our neighbors, those that live around us, our families? The Pharisees had this belief: if this keeps going, then all people are going to believe in him. Wouldn't that be awesome? So one of the things that I want us to see about this resurrection life is it takes us from a place of just having knowledge about who God is and what God's capable of doing, and even the fact that Jesus rose from the dead, just not just knowing that, but living like we believe that. Well, let's jump forward a little bit. We've seen that example of the resurrection of Lazarus, but let's jump forward a little bit and let's look in the Gospel of John still at the resurrection account of Jesus Christ and the people that were surrounding that resurrection, and that was his disciples. In John chapter 20, it says, as it came near the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went, when it was yet dark, went into the sepulcher and seeth the stone taken away from the sepulcher. And she runneth and cometh to Simon Peter and the other disciple, who we know is John, whom Jesus loved. And he said unto them, they have taken away the Lord out of the sepulcher, and we know not where they have laid him. So here we go. It's the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Except they're on the other side of it. And the only thing they can think is that somebody has stolen the body of Jesus. So Peter and John, they run to the tomb. Peter bursts into the tomb, sees the cloth laying there. John makes his way in, and it says in the end of verse 8 that he saw and he believed. Well, what did he believe? He believed what Mary had said. Somebody's taken the body. It's not here. How do you know that, preacher? Because verse 9 says this: For as yet they knew not the scripture that he must rise again from the dead. As many times as they'd been told, they were blinded to that truth. All they could think was somebody's taken the body of Jesus. How did they respond? Verse 10 says, and the disciples went away again to their own home. They went to their dwelling places in Jerusalem. They were discouraged. They were disheartened. Not only had they watched the person that they had followed and loved and cared about beaten, crucified, buried, now his body had been stolen. They were disheartened. They went back, and it says in verse 19, the same day in the evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews. Jesus had risen from the dead. They didn't understand it. They didn't believe it. They didn't accept it. And they were hiding in fear. I'm going to tell you what, guys, there's a whole lot of people living in the world today that don't know and don't understand about the resurrection of Jesus Christ. They don't understand that truth. They don't believe that reality. And guys, they're living in fear. They live their life in fear on a constant basis. You say, no, they don't. They're out partying. They're out doing this. They're having a good time. But when they're by themselves and they think about their future, they're afraid. How you know that, preacher? Because that's where I was at. I did that very same thing. I lived up life. I had a good time. But when I was alone by myself, And I would stop to think about my life and about the future. I was afraid. And there's so many people in that predicament today around the world that are living in fear because they don't believe in a resurrected Savior. They don't accept, they don't know that truth. The disciples we're looking at today, you say, well, they believed in who Jesus was. Yeah, but they didn't have the reality of the resurrection. What they had believed in was lying dead in a grave somewhere, what they thought. The body had been stolen. And yet what happens? All of a sudden, Jesus walks in the very next words, and Jesus came and stood in the midst saying, peace be unto you. Isn't that wonderful? That our risen Savior wants to bring us peace. Today, I don't know what you're going through, but the reality of the resurrection is you can have a life of peace. You don't have to live with a spirit of fear of a virus or a pandemic or loss of a paycheck or the illness of a family member. The reality of the resurrection says you can have peace in your life. And that's what the Lord longs for you to have. It's one of the reasons that the resurrection took place, is that we wouldn't have to live in bondage to sin, but we could have peace and get rid of that sin debt. If you notice, though, and I want to just go a little bit further, that seeing Jesus didn't provide them that peace. We know that Jesus appeared many times to the disciples and to many others over the next 40 days. But yet, as you look through Scripture, the disciples struggled with the reality of Jesus being alive and what their purpose was going forward. Matter of fact, if you go to verse 21, Peter, who was right there with these guys when Jesus appeared, decided, you know what? I'm going fishing. I'm going back to Galilee and I'm going back to fishing. If you read over in the Great Commission, Matthew chapter 28, verse 17, right before Jesus issues the Great Commission, what does it say? And it says, here's the disciples and some other folks, and they're sitting there and they're worshiping, but some doubted. What did they doubt? That Jesus was alive? No, he's right there in front of them. They know that the resurrection is a reality. What they're doubting is, should we still follow him? Is the plan still the same? Man, we just saw the Romans take him and put him on a cross and put him in a tomb. And yes, he rose from the dead, but do we still follow him? They were struggling not with knowledge of a fact, but they were struggling with living in the reality that the resurrection had taken place and what God's plan was for them. I want you to follow me just a little bit further. You say, preacher, you're kind of rambling around. It may seem like it, but I want you to go with me over to the book of Acts. Because here's the disciples, and they're struggling with following Jesus. The resurrection is a reality in their mind. They can see that it's happened. But yet they're not living as if the resurrection has taken place. We come to Acts chapter 1. Jesus has them in Jerusalem. They go outside the city, and he shares with them at the time right before his ascension. And he says in verse number 8 of Acts chapter 1, but you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. You shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the uttermost parts of the earth. He gives them a task. If we were to go over to, I just mentioned it, Matthew 28, the Great Commission, and he says, you know, you go and make disciples. You can go to Mark chapter 16, where he gives the commission to go into all the world and preach the gospel. Here's the disciples that have been struggling with the reality of the resurrection for a month now, a little over a month. They've seen it, but they don't know how to live in it. Jesus ascends into heaven, and in Acts chapter 2, something amazing happens. It says in verse number 1, and when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all in one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the houses where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like a fire, and it sat upon each of them. Look at this. And they were filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Something's happened, guys, that's changed in their lives. The Father had made them a promise, and that promise was that they'd be filled with the Spirit of God. When that took place in Acts chapter 2, the amazing thing wasn't that they spoke in tongues. The amazing thing is they spoke what the Spirit gave them to say. From that point forward, those scared, discouraged, wandering disciples became powerful preachers of the gospel. If you go down to verse 14, and Peter, standing up with the 11, lifted up his voice and said unto them, "Ye men of Judah, and all ye that dwell at Jerusalem, be this known unto you, and hearken to my words." And he preached the gospel. You can go down to verse 24 through the end of the chapter, and he preaches to them about the resurrection of Jesus Christ, a fact that he'd known for over a month, but now he was living in. You see, he went from knowledge to understanding through the help of the Holy Spirit that God had a plan for his life, and he was living out that plan. I would challenge you this morning with the question that I began with. Are you living a resurrection type of life? I didn't ask you, did you believe in the resurrection? I didn't ask you if you knew about the resurrection. Matter of fact, if you go over to Romans chapter 10 and verses 9 through 11, and it's that little passage there where it's talking about how you can be saved. You know, in that passage, it doesn't say that you know that Jesus rose from the dead. It says, do you believe it? Well, what's the difference, preacher? You can have knowledge about something and it not affect the way you live. But when you believe something, it affects the outcome. It affects what you do. Do you believe? Do you truly believe that Jesus Christ rose from the dead? You see, resurrection living is living with the abiding presence of the promise of the Father. What is that? That's the Holy Spirit. You see, the disciples struggled because they didn't have that Holy Spirit living inside of them. They were seeing Jesus, but they were struggling in the flesh. But when the Spirit of God took up residence in their life on that day of Pentecost, now they were ready to live the truth that they knew. Well, how does that affect me, preacher? Because when you accepted Christ as your Savior, guess who indwells your body now and your being now? The Spirit of God. You have the presence of the Spirit of God living inside of you. The question is, are you going to surrender to that Spirit? Are you going to live a resurrection life? A resurrection life is a life that's lived with the abiding presence of the promise of the Father, the Holy Spirit, believing that Jesus is the Christ, trusting that God's word is truth, and being committed that you will live the will of God that he has for you. How about it? Do you believe that Jesus is the Christ? Are you trusting in God's word? Are you committed that the Father has a plan for your life and that you're going to live it? You see, that's living a resurrected life. Again, church, it's not enough just to know. It's when that knowledge becomes belief, and that belief, spurred on by the Spirit of God, challenges us, and we accept that challenge to live in God's promise, following the guidance of the Holy Spirit. That's what I want you to think about this morning. Man, here we are. We're celebrating Easter. Is it just an event? Is it a one-day thing? Is tomorrow it over? Not if you're living a resurrection life. Not if you're walking in with the Spirit guiding you on a daily basis. And I want to encourage you today. There may be some of you that are listening on Facebook today, and you know, you hadn't ever really come to the place where you've accepted Christ as your Savior. You've never given your heart to Jesus. You never received the forgiveness of your sins. I cannot imagine a better day than today, Easter Sunday 2020, to give your life to Jesus Christ. Not to have to live in fear, but to have the peace of knowing that your sins are forgiven, that there's a plan for your life, and that you've got something you can trust in that's greater than what's going on around you. So I want to encourage you today, if you don't know Christ as your Savior, I just want you to bow your heads. I want to ask you to say this simple prayer. Say, Father, today I come to you and I realize that I'm a sinner and that I need a Savior. And Lord, I want the forgiveness of my sins. I want to accept the gift of eternal life. I want to live with your peace and in your presence, with you guiding me and directing me. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Please save me. Amen. If you prayed that prayer and accepted Christ as your personal Savior, I would encourage you. You can contact these guys here at Crossroads. They would love to shoot them a message. They would love to talk to you about how they can help you out in your walk with the Lord. And maybe, again, you're here and you're a believer. And you say, you know what, preacher, I have been struggling with living that resurrection life. And as we close out this morning, what I'd like to do is just offer a prayer for you as well. And so if you would, let's bow together. Father, we come to the close of our time together today. Just a moment, we're going to have a time of invitation, a song that Brother Mitch is going to share. And Lord, I would pray that as the song's being played, maybe some folks here would just feel led as they watch this over the internet to just come to you, to bow before you, to humble themselves in your presence. Lord, and to ask that they could have more out of their Christian life than just a knowledge of who God is and what he's done for them. But Lord, they could live in the reality, believing, making an impact, a change in their life, and allowing the Holy Spirit to help them follow your plan for them. Lord, would you please do this for those folks that are desiring that today? In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Thank you for letting me share with you this morning.
Yeah. Christ Jesus lives today. That's what Resurrection Sunday, Easter, is all about. And we're so grateful for that truth. And I'm grateful that you have spent time worshiping with us today as we continue to celebrate all that Jesus has done for us, and the fact that there is nobody in that tomb. That tomb is empty. That cross is empty. But our hearts are full because Jesus is alive. Would you pray as we close our time of worship this morning? Father God, we thank you so much for how you bless us. We thank you for beautiful sunshine. We thank you for rain. We thank you for your daily provision. And we thank you, Lord, that we can celebrate today the truth, the reality that Jesus Christ is alive. And he is worthy of our praise. So we have gathered today in this unusual way to worship you, to honor you, to love you with our singing, with our praying, with our spending time in your word. And we did all of this, Lord, because of who you are and because of what you did at the cross. We love you, Lord. We love you because you are a risen, living Savior. In Jesus' name.